Hello everybody, glad you could make it. My name is Kaylee Allen and welcome to another Rare Plant Index. If you do not already know what a Rare Plant Index is by now, a Rare Plant Index is basically a series that I run here on YouTube where I take a type of plant and I categorize it between uncommon, rare, very rare, extremely rare, and holy. As you may have seen by the title, this week's video is the coveted Monstera episode. I will quickly tell you guys about anything pertinent specifically to this episode. The first thing is, usually I would not necessarily separate a variegated version of a plant from a regular version of a plant. I would simply just say, you know, this plant has a variegated version. However, I'm not going to do that in this Monstera Rare Plant Index for good reason. It will probably become apparent as I explain more about the plants. I needed to explain more about the plants, so that's why they have been separated for the purpose of this episode. I will also start by saying this was extremely difficult to research. That is why it's been in the pipeline for some time, because honestly, most of us only maybe know of a few different types of Monstera, and beyond that, they just aren't known, they aren't kept in people's houses, they aren't documented. Like, there's not a lot of information on these plants, so this has been very, very difficult to identify all of these different types of Monstera. That said, I think there are around 50 species of Monstera. I'm going to cover around about 30 of them, so I have done my best. A couple of people have asked me to include more than one photograph of these plants. Normally I would say yes, no problem, but to be honest with you, a lot of these plants are so rare, sometimes there is only one photograph, or the photograph I have is not the best photograph, but it's all that I have to show you guys, so I do apologize if you're not able to get a good sense of the plant. However, in most scenarios, I probably can't do too much about that. I will, of course, try and do it where I can, but I guess as we move up the ranks to extremely rare, you're probably not going to see multiple photographs. One last disclaimer, what is rare for me may not be rare for you. I'm situated in the UK. Those of you in America or Australia or, you know, somewhere in Europe, you may have different experiences on how easy or difficult it is to come by these plants based on where geographically you are in the world. So please don't come for me if I put something in very rare and it's like growing out of the ground where you live. I'm very, very sorry. I had to just take a general consensus of what is rare and what is not. All right, let's get started. So we will start with common because I would like to tell you guys about a lot of the common Monstera that you may or may not know of. And I will kick things straight off with the Monstera deliciosa. Now, everyone has probably seen these before. These are what everyone typically thinks of when they think of a Monstera. This is the first plant that comes to mind. This particular Monstera, the deliciosa, does have leaves that can reach quite large sizes. We're talking like easily 1 to 2 feet in size in the tropics. That said, even in the home, they can still get quite large. Conversely, in common, we have the Monstera borzigiana. Now, a lot of people think this is just Monstera deliciosa. It's not. It's actually a separate plant. It's not the same. It is basically kind of known as a dwarf version of a Monstera deliciosa, and it's not really considered a true Monstera, if that makes any sense. A lot of people will have this sold to them as deliciosa, but it is very, very different. The plant, the leaves don't, you know, reach the same size, and the growth habit of a borzigiana versus a deliciosa is different. A borzigiana will have more of a vining-like growth pattern, and it's probably more likely to be sat on a moss pole, whereas a regular deliciosa doesn't need a moss pole. There's no need for it. It's just not the growth pattern that it has. There are other couple of ways to tell the difference between these two plants, but the borzigiana has to reach more of a mature level in order to be able to differentiate it between that and a deliciosa. I could do a video on that if you're interested, but honestly, it'd be a very short video. The next plant on the list is none other than the Monstera adansonii. This is a smaller vining Monstera. People usually grow this and have it trailing, but you can grow it upwards as well. There is more than one type of Monstera adansonii. I will very, very quickly run through them. This here, this very sad looking cutting, I'll try and hold it up here. This is regular form Monstera adansonii. This here, direct from NSE Tropicals, is Monstera narrow form adansonii. So still adansonii, but a little bit different. And this third one here is Monstera adansonii round form. So different again, lots of holes still, but still adansonii. Just wanted to mention that really quickly because I think a lot of people don't realize that there's different forms out there and they're all adansonii. Right, starting with uncommon. So the first plant I have in uncommon is the Monstera dubaia. Now I have one here, I will show you in a minute, but this is a very, very beautiful plant. It is known as a shingle plant due to the way it grows. A lot of people grow this on a plank of wood, say, than a moss pole, just due to the fact that, you know, it keeps the plant actually flat, which is how it prefers to grow. It is worth mentioning that there is a similar plant out there to this, and that is the Raphidophora cryptantha. If you want to tell the difference between these plants, a Monstera dubaia's leaves will point down to the root. Raphidophora cryptantha leaves will point up to the sky. I will very quickly show you a Monstera Dubai that I have here. It is not mounted yet because I haven't found a plank of wood. There you go, that is Monstera Dubai right there. It is absolutely beautiful. I highly recommend them. I don't think they're too difficult to get a hold of. Moving on, we have the Monstera Carstenianum or Peru. I think it was previously known as Carstenianum. Now it's known as Monstera Peru, I guess. The leaves on this are extremely fleshy and bumpy. I really, really like the texture on this one. This is very, very nice. When you feel the leaves, they are extremely like robust, I want to say, and hard. It's just not what you expect from feeling a leaf. They're very, very cool. I do have one of these, but I'm going to mention it a little bit later on. I think this is a vining plant, but you could also grow it up a moss pole as well if you wanted to. Moving on from that, we have the Monstera Pinnati Partita, and I own one of these, and it is the best thing, can I just tell you. I will probably insert some footage of it now, but it's actually behind me right there in the back in the frame. Wonderful, wonderful plant. I actually think at the moment that mine might flower as of recording this video. Hopefully in a week's time, when you actually see this video, it may have flowered, I don't know. But I'm very excited for that. These can grow to be very, very large as well. They don't really have holes in them. It is more just the splits, I would say. So if you're not too fussed on having holes on a Monstera, but you like the split aspect, then this is definitely one for you. They're not too difficult to get a hold of, but you might have to do some digging. Can totally, totally recommend it. The growth pattern on these probably isn't for everybody, but I love them. I'm so pleased to have one. It's one of my favorite plants at the minute. Moving on to rare, the first plant on our list is the Monstera Siltipicana. This is very, very pretty. I'm pretty sure it's on my wish list, mainly because of the dimension in the leaves, the shape of the leaves, and even the color of the leaves are really, really nice. I do think these look better when they're juvenile. I will try and insert some images now of what a mature Siltipicana looks like, and it looks, again, very, very different. So this is another form of Monstera that I would consider to be more beautiful, should we say, when it's in juvenile form. Right. Now we have some really, really interesting entries on the list, because the next plant on the list for rare for Monstera is the Monstera Albo Borzagiana. Now, this one is very, very nice. It is basically a Monstera Borzagiana that I mentioned earlier, the dwarf form, but this is variegated and it has white variegation on it. The variegation is particularly nice on these plants because it does tend to be reasonably sectoral, which I guess I just mean it's in large sections and it's chunky. They are massively, massively sought after at the moment, so although they're not impossible to find, the price tag on them is to match. It's a lot of money. You can get cuttings of these probably a lot more readily than getting a full-size plant. It is worth noting that the variegation on this plant and some other plants is not stable. What that means is the variegation in this plant is a genetic mutation or a genetic defect, which means it can revert back the other way. So if you want this plant, you need to be aware that there is a little bit of work there, but because the variegation is a genetic defect, that is why this plant is harder to come by. Similarly, the Monstera Alba Borzagiana is the exact same situation, except the variegation is yellow. And I honestly think this is rarer than the Albo Borzagiana, because I never really say this. I would like one of these, actually. They're quite nice. I don't normally go for yellow variegation, but this is actually really, really nice. The variegation on this is unstable, so it can revert. Now then, the next plant on my list for rare is the Monstera Deliciosa Thai Constellation. Now this one is brilliant, and let me tell you why. There are a few reasons. One, this is a variegated form of an actual Monstera Deliciosa, which means if you would like it to, it can get very, very large. You know, the same size that a Monstera Deliciosa can get. And if you own an actual Deliciosa, you will understand what I'm talking about. They get quite large. Secondly, the variegation that you see before you on this plant is stable, which means the plant grows like this. You never have to worry about this plant reverting. This is genetically, this is what this plant is. It's what it's supposed to be. It's not a mutation. This is how it grows. You will never have to worry about this plant reverting. So if you want a variegated Monstera and you don't want to just stress about trying to keep the variegation or wondering, you know, will it revert? Will I end up wasting my money and not have a variegated one anymore? Please do not hesitate to go and get a Thai constellation, because they are beautiful. The variegation on these is a little bit visually different to the Borzagiana variegata. It does still have chunky variegation on it. The variegation, I wouldn't say, is white. It's more of an off-white slash cream. And throughout the entire leaf, it has speckles of white. To be honest, resembling a constellation, which is probably where this Monstera gets its name from. I do have one of them here with me, and if you've been subscribed to me for any period of time, you will already know this, but I will just pull it out for you now, because it's doing very well, and it's getting a new leaf, and I'm very excited. Here, if I can show you this leaf here, you can see there is a lot of chunky variegation on there. It's a new leaf there. But generally speaking, the pattern is much more of like a constellation, speckled type pattern. But more importantly, that is how the plant just grows. Moving on, that's enough about that. Moving on, we have the Monstera Carsteniainum / Peru Variegata. I wanted to mention this separately, just because this is much harder to find generally than the regular one. The variegation in these is a genetic defect, so it also can revert. So not in the same way as the Thai constellation I just showed you. This can go back green, so this one you do have to be careful with, and you do have to watch the variegation on it. Moving on to some of the weirder Monstera. This is Monstera asseminata, I think that's how you say it. In juvenile photographs, this does look similar to a Monstera adansonii, very similar in fact, but I assure you it is not. A lot of people seem to be tagging adansonii on Instagram as this plant or something else. I think in a juvenile form, this plant is difficult to identify due to the fact it does look similar to adansonii, so I guess you can't really identify this plant until it does mature, so that's a thing. It's nice, but I think there's so many Monstera that I would have over this, I'm not really interested in having this one. Moving on from that, we have the Monstera spruciana, I think it is called. This is similar to the Monstera Panati Partita, sort of. This one does not get holes either. I haven't seen it in any store, so I don't know if it's really a thing in people's houses, but I don't really have any information about this, I'm afraid, because as I say, it's rare. I don't really know anything about it. It could be in the wrong category. I don't even know. Moving up now to very rare, and it starts to get interesting. This is the Monstera Standaliana Variegata. Both Albo and Alba, I have clumped them into the same one. Basically, you can have the Albo variegation, which is white, and the Alba variegation, which is yellow. Both are very, very nice. I do have one here, which I will just put my tablet down so I can quickly show you. Da, 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 da. Here we go. This is one with white variegation here. This is what it looks like. It's only a little one, but this is a really nice one as well. I think it prefers to grow up something, so a moss pole would probably be needed for that, but it's very gorgeous if you can get your hands on either one. The next one on the list I'm a little bit surprised at, because if I were to just see this, I would actually think it was a philodendron and not a Monstera. But this is the Monstera subpinnata, and people might disagree with me here, but to me it kind of looks like half Monstera, half palm, kind of in a way. I have seen this on a lot of Instagram photos, and it just looks really, really delicate. I really do like the look of it. I would have one of these just because I'm really interested in collecting Monstera, and it's definitely kind of like a weirder one to add to a collection, so I do like it. It's just very unique from all the Monstera that we've seen so far on this list. Next up, we have the Monstera Leschleriana, and this one, I'm going to stop right here and say that this one confused me a lot. I'm not entirely sure what we're looking at here. I've seen some posts of what is supposedly a Leschleriana, and it looks very different to the images I found from doing research. The Leschleriana I found seems to resemble the Monstera Panati Partita a little bit. And these other Monstera on Instagram just look like vining Monstera. And when I say Panati Partita, I think I'm talking about the growth pattern, because I'm looking at this photograph now and it looks nothing like Panati Partita. So I think what I meant there was the growth pattern. I don't know anything about this one, guys. If I don't know something, I will always tell you that I don't know it. So I'm just gonna move on. Next on the list, we have a very beautiful Monstera. This is Monstera epipremnoides. This is the Monstera right here in front of the frame. I probably won't move it because there's not a lot of point. You can kind of see it here. I'll just not put an image up just yet. This is very, very nice. This here, I think, is a juvenile form. I know it looks like a large adansonii, but I promise you it is not. When these things get mature, I will insert a picture right now. They are very, very different to what you see before you. These things change so much as they grow. It's nigh on impossible to tell what, to be honest. I don't think I'll ever see one in real life other than basically this cutting, and it's not mine. I have to send it back, so I've enjoyed my time with it, but I'm not sure I'll ever see another one again. Right, extremely rare, and I'm pretty sure there are a lot in this category because I can't find information on these Monstera. But I will start it off with a plant that, I mean, I cannot see anything on this image. I have an image of it far away, and I have an image of close up of a leaf. and really they don't really show the plant, so I'm going to do my best. But this first item on the list for extremely rare is Monstera membranacea. I don't know if that's the right word, but we're going to go with it. So this one was pretty much impossible to find photographs of due to its rarity, so I will show you what I can, but apologize if the photos just are pretty terrible. I've found whatever I can. I can't even say too much about it because as of recording, I haven't been able to find much, and the battery died on my camera, so if my framing has changed, that is why I've had to stop everything and replace the battery. One moment. Right, where were we? Next on the list, we have the Monstera barrieri. Well, let's call it Barry. Again, this is another Monstera I've seen very different images of on the internet. I actually swapped out this image last minute because I think I had the wrong Monstera. So this could potentially be wrong. I quite like it. Next on the list is a highly sought after Monstera. It is very hard to find. It is also very expensive. And that is the Monstera adansonii variegata. This is another reason I wanted to show separate entries for variegated plants, just because of the level of how rare this particular plant is. They do cost an awful lot of money. I will include very quickly a listing for NSE Tropicals, selling one on eBay last year that looked like it went possibly above £1,000. 58 bids at £1,000 is the image that I'm looking at. So let's just assume it sold for £1,000, just to give you an idea of how sought after these plants actually are. It's obviously on my wish list to get one. I don't know how possible it is. Maybe they are a lot more common now. I don't really know. If you do have one, you're extremely lucky. Congratulations. It is also super rare because the variegation is a genetic defect and therefore would need to be preserved. So that is probably why the price is sky high. Very, very nice. Do let me know if you have one of these. I'd be very interested to know how many of you do actually own one of these, because I'm pretty sure they are super, super rare. I don't think I've misplaced this in the list. I do think they're very rare. Next on the list is the Monstera dissector. Now this, it's kind of weird. It does remind me of a Monstera, but actually the image that I'm probably showing you now, the leaves kind of remind me of the leaves of a peace lily. I don't know if that's just the color of the leaves in this image and the texture, I guess. I don't know, it's different. You can tell it's a Monstera, although it does look a little bit like a Raphidophora, but it is a Monstera. Moving on, I do like this one quite a lot. This is the Monstera dilacerata. It's really, really nice. There are no particular holes in this one. It is more of a split, but I just think this is quite a fancy looking Monstera compared to all of them. Do you know what I mean? It just looks fancy. Like, as I say, it doesn't have any holes in, but I don't really mind. It's very, very nice. I like the Pinnati Partita for the same reason. Very, very, very pretty Monstera, that one. Next up, we have the Monstera punctulata. It is the opposite of the dilacerata in the way that it is mainly consisting of holes that make up the leaves, you know, appearance, shall we say. I don't know much about this one, of course. It is extremely rare, so I can't tell you too much about it. This is McMitty here showing you what a mature punctulata looks like, and it's quite awesome. It's weird. I don't think I'll ever see that in person. And I think this is, you know, getting into serious territory now, but it is very nice. This next one is quite a nice Monstera again. This is the Monstera xanthospatha, or xanthospatha. I think it's xanthospatha. I really, really like this one, to be honest with you. It does look quite interesting. From images I've seen, it doesn't seem to have that many holes. I think, again, it's a maturity thing when it does get these holes. The holes that it does have do seem to be significantly larger than a few other species that we've already covered. So that's, I guess that's an interesting point to note. Next up on the list, I nearly didn't put this on the list because I could find one image for this Monstera and I don't really know what to do about it because it's a terrible image. You can't really see anything. I can't really identify anything from it, but I'm going to put it in anyway. This is the Monstera egregia. You pick one photograph on the internet and that's it. So I'm not really sure what I can say other than it is a Monstera and it exists. Do with that what you will. Moving straight on, we have the Monstera tenui. I really, really like this one. Again, I kind of get palm tree vibes from it. I don't know what it is. This one's awesome. I really like that. That's nice. I could just imagine if I had a tropical garden somewhere, God knows where, in California or something. I would have one of those in the garden because it just looks so cool. Moving on, we have the Monstera acoiagensis matuta. Another large Monstera. This one appears to have more holes again as opposed to splits. I don't know much about this one either. I only found it a couple of hours ago before filming this, but I wanted to pop it in, so here it is. Okay, this one, I quite like this one because it's going to look very reminiscent of something else when I show you the image of what it is, But this is the Monstera Praeta Missa. What a lovely name. This Monstera may look a lot like another Monstera that we probably have coming up a little bit later. If you can't tell what I'm talking about, I think personally it is very reminiscent of an obliqua in the way that the holes are and just the general appearance of the shape of the leaf. So I thought that was quite interesting to show you because it's like an obliqua but not an obliqua. Similarly, the next plant on the list is the Monstera Expilata. Expilata, apparently. Again, a little bit similar to the previous Monstera we've just looked at, the Praeta Missa, only these leaf shapes are much, much broader, and I guess the gaps between the holes are, I guess, you know, chunkier, so it's less thin in appearance, I guess, as the one we've just looked at. Again, I don't have much information on this either, so I do apologize, but as I say, we are in the extremely rare category, and it always gets hard at this stage in, to be honest, any rare plant index, because I get a plant, I might find one photograph of it, I can't even guarantee the validity of that photograph of it, so I have to run with it. But even if I run with it, because there's one photograph and one listing, I don't necessarily get any information about it, and I can't spend, you know, 6 hours of researching one plant, so I apologize, but for this plant and certainly a few other plants I've mentioned so far, there just isn't very much information on it. And that is the end of the extremely rare category, which obviously I think we all knew what was coming. In Holy, we have the Monstera obliqua. I have done a full video on the differences between obliqua and adansonii featuring a real obliqua. I will show it in a minute. It's just down here out of frame. But basically what I want to say very quickly is this plant is much, much rarer than the Philodendron Spiritus Sancti, which a lot of people say is, you know, the holy grail of philodendron. This plant is way, way rarer than that. This is like just very few people have it. Like, I don't even know how many people have it in America, maybe 10 people. Like, I don't even know. Not many people, and even then, it's probably grown in a botanical garden and it doesn't belong to a person, if that makes sense, and it's under conservation. So the one I have here is actually on loan right now, and it looks like this. If you have not seen last week's video, I highly suggest you watch it. It's very, very informational, because this Monstera obliqua has these weird stolons or runners coming off it. The video I did last week explains wholeheartedly what they are and what they're for and why they occur, but all you need to know for this video is that this is a genuine Monstera obliqua, Peruvian form. This has been confirmed by Mick Mittermeier, who I've mentioned before. He has confirmed its authenticity. This is a Monstera obliqua. I will show you it up close, right there. And before I get any comments on the whole 90% whole thing, please, please, please watch last week's video, because it will clear it all up if you are interested. If this is the first time you've stumbled across my channel, I will link that video down below in the description as well, so you can pop over and have a look at that as soon as you've finished watching this video. That is the end of the Monstera Rare Plant Index. I'm very sorry this took a while to get out. I've had a lot to do in the way of Monstera. The video I did last week took a lot. I don't know if it came across because I'm recording this on the same day, so I don't know how it came off, but it took a lot to make that video. Similarly, it took a lot to make this Rare Plant Index because I'm willing to bet that a lot of Monstera on that list no one had really heard of, whereas, you know, when I do a video on Alocasia or Calathea or what else have I done, Philodendron, like, you're probably going to have heard of a lot of these plants, whereas I think in the case of Monstera there's a lot that you may not have heard of. A lot of them do look similar, I apologize. That is the nature of Monstera, especially I find when they get mature they look a lot like each other, which doesn't really help at all. But thank you for being very, very patient with me, and if you would like to see a rare plant index on any other types of plants, then please feel free to just fire off a request in the description, either make it a list, leave one comment, it doesn't really matter. Please let me know if there's any Monstera on this list that you would like, or that you have, or you're interested in. Just, I would love to just get a feel of what you guys like. Similarly, in terms of variegation, do you prefer white variegation? Do you prefer yellow variegation? Because I think I prefer white variegation, but there's something about that Alba Monstera, the yellow variegated one, that is actually quite striking. So, maybe I should go for some yellow variegation and stop filling up the house with white variegation, I don't know. But thank you very, very much for watching this video. Hopefully it was not too long, I don't really know as of editing because my camera went down halfway through, so I'm not really sure, but hopefully I have not kept you too long. I will quickly mention, even though I mentioned it in my last video, a lot of these plants, this one, the adansonii I showed you, and the obliqua itself, they are not my plants, they are on loan. So please do not expect to see them in future videos. Don't expect, you know, updates on growth. I don't have that information. It's not my plant. They are on loan. I'm very grateful to have spent any time with any of these plants, especially this little guy. I'm actually going to miss him quite a lot. It's very sad. But as I said in my last video, I'm very privileged to have even, you know, had this in my house, even for a short period of time. So that has been an honor and a privilege. Thank you very, very much for watching. I hope you have a fantastic Friday, a fantastic weekend, and I will see you in the next video. I do not know as of recording what that video is, but hopefully I will come up with something. Thank you very, very much for watching, and I will see you in the next one. Bye!